Hi, Cristina here, founder of Liberate. I wanted to let you know that all of our amazing practitioners, healers, and intuitives are available for remote sessions. And we are continuously adding new classes, workshops, and meditations to serve you every week. Thank you for joining us, and I hope that we can help you liberate yourself.
It's all just new information.
Coming at you in whatever vibration. Good vibration.
Hi, this is Cristina Dam, and this is Liberate the Podcast, where we educate, motivate, inspire, and liberate your consciousness.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Liberate the Podcast. Today, we're going to be talking about intuition, both from kind of like more the scientific realm, which is really fascinating, and the metaphysical realm, and really about developing your intuition and the wisdom and power behind it. And so much other things. You know how we do it. We kind of steer off track here. But today, this guest over sitting on my left here is Michael Carson, and he is a coach, a hypnotherapist, and also he helps teach and guide people through developing their intuition. So that's what he's here. We're going to learn a lot. I'm excited because I love the subject and I think it's so helpful and practical in everyday life. So welcome.
Thank you, Cristina. It is great to be here. Thrilled to meet you and the dogs and everything.
Yeah. And you know, everybody, they might jump up at times, but they just went on a 4-hour hike, so they might be okay.
They're energizing us as we as we dive into intuition. But no, I really appreciate the warm introduction. And you know, intuition is a topic for me that wasn't one I ever thought I would be teaching or focusing on until I started to learn about it and look back at my life and realized, wow, I've been developing my intuition in some really powerful ways without realizing it. And I think my hope actually is that as people listen, people actually realize I'm way more powerful intuitively than I had a clue of. And that simply recognizing it is the activation of your superpower of psychic intuition.
I like that, calling it the superpower. Mm-hmm. And also that it applies to everybody, in that you had this experience of not even realizing how much you had developed that tool. And we can look at it as a tool because it's, I think a lot of people judge it as a gift, but it's really a tool.
Right.
So you work the tool, you know, your muscles are a tool for you to walk and move. And this is a tool that's there for you and it's not a gift. I think that's an important thing.
Yeah. Some, I would say maybe the people we would say are gifted in intuition are the people who are just kind of, for whatever reason, like the pianists who have a year of piano lessons and they're playing, you know, the most complex etude. Some people are just more naturally able, but we all have the tool and it's a matter of just looking at it and recognizing it.
I really like that metaphor, because I think that's, I mean, I'm just reiterating that because it really hit, but you know, I think anybody, if you put in a little bit of effort and energy and some lessons, you can learn to play the guitar, you can learn to play the piano. Yep. You might not be a savant and you might not have this huge career with it, but can you play a few different tunes and some songs and can you play them well? And the more you practice, can you play them better? Absolutely. Yep. You know, and but then there's some people that they can just and you're like, wow.
I envy those musicians, but and I think also intuition, I mean, I think in a moment we should actually say, what do we think is intuition? How do we define it?
That would help too, because I mean, I think it's a word that's thrown around a lot, and a lot of people have, you know, most of the people that are watching are driven because you're already fascinated with metaphysical realms, but even within that, it's looked at as hooey-wooey, right? But it doesn't have to be.
It doesn't have to be. And I was going to say, too, you know, intuition speaks to individuals in different ways. People have different sort of skills within the realm of intuition. You might hear like in the modern mystery school, very metaphysical, you know, ancient tradition of being psychic and remote viewing, they talk about clairaudience, clairvoyance, different ways in which are you hearing things? Are you seeing synchronicities in your life? Mm-hmm. So intuition has different signatures for how it speaks to people. So again, I think that's...
How would you define it though? Let's backtrack.
Let's backtrack to that. Yes. How would I define it? So a couple of ways I like to think of intuition, and I just kind of threw out a few different definitions that I've learned or put together over the years, again, because, you know, intuition can be metaphysical, it can be spiritual, it can be personal, practical. There's even people who bring intuition into the business world. So intuition, very simply to me, is having access to information without really knowing where you got it from. It's like, I didn't read it in a book, no one told it to me, I didn't look it up, but somehow I knew. You know, I knew to make this phone call today instead of that one. I knew to go to this place, which didn't really fit with my schedule or wasn't my plan, but I did it anyway. And something happened that was, you know, synchronistic and helped me reach a goal. So just having information or thoughts come up, ideas, and not really knowing where they came from. And really, as we get into it, the mechanics of it, you know, there's lots of ways that we tap into sort of the collective unconscious of information around us. Another way to think about intuition is mobile attention. We were just chatting a little earlier, I was mentioning like remote viewing, which is people who can, in their mind's eye, actually locate visually, can see another location.
Now this is the metaphysical, like, crazy stuff, which is interesting because I just learned like the real like history of where metaphysical came from, and it was all in science based, and it was nothing of the study of the supernatural. It was this metaphor, there was this science, and then it was these things that outside of science. Mm-hmm. And so really metaphysical means the study of things outside of science. Mm-hmm. But really, I mean, that can be a classification of anything. Mm-hmm. You know? And so that was just the way that they approached it. And it was more of this term that was used in the scientific community. And then somehow then it went into the supernatural. Mm-hmm. And then what we know of it now is more of a term used for supernatural, not for anything outside of the fundamentals of what is studied in regular normative science.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's a whole rabbit hole of history there, right? Of different ways, you know, quote unquote, metaphysical topics have been sort of framed in a way that makes them seem more kind of woo woo or more.
Now it's almost, how do you say that word? Synonymous. Metaphysical means super. Means supernatural.
Right.
But it doesn't. Right. By definition, it doesn't. But that's what we know it to mean right now. Okay, right. So remote viewing.
Remote viewing. So another way to think about intuition is mobile attention. Intuition speaks to me very clearly, and I think to everyone, where, you know, if you ever notice yourself kind of getting distracted by some topic or idea, and you're like, no, that's not what I need to spend my time on. And, you know, your attention just keeps going different places, and learning how to follow where your attention goes, the images that come to mind that you might not realize have a significance. Following your attention and we'll get into the sort of the neuroscience of this, you know, when you're really lined up with your gut, with your heart, and when you start to, you know, have thoughts coming in, you know, you follow your attention, and that kind of takes you places. That's kind of how the universe guides us in a lot of ways through our intuition. Mm-hmm. And everybody has the experience of that, you know, friend you haven't talked to in 5 years, who you're like, I should call that person. And who calls you that day? You know, it's the friend from 5 years ago. And you think, well, what a coincidence. And, you know, I don't know how many times you've heard in the spiritual world, there are no coincidences.
Yeah.
And, right. And, you know, that experience of being in the bookstore and, you know, looking for some book that you end up not buying because some other book just like literally fell off the shelf on your floor, on your foot, and just change the course of, you know, 5 years later, you're in a new career. because of that, you know?
Or you hear often about like the bond between a child and a parent, right?
Yeah.
Whether a mother and or a father, especially you hear more about the mother and the child bonds, but that they just have this, we'll call it sixth sense of knowing when something's wrong, something's up, something's different, you know, and even sometimes can feel when their child, even grown, is sick or ill, or, you know, there's just this connection that is beyond that what you would think would be logical.
Right. And a lot of that is all precognitive. You know, mothers don't think, oh, I'm using my, you know, transpersonal, like unconscious connection with my child to know what they need. Mothers just know.
And you do know, you think, okay, so on this, and this will be like a segue into the science behind it.
Sure.
You know, I love animals and, you know, I have two dogs, as many people know that watch, but they have instincts, right? Just ways of being and knowing of certain things that are up. But you think then you go and you translate that from dogs into other animals, like, you know, the salmon just know how to go back to their place where they were born and make that voyage, or that, you know, whales or dolphins do this certain, like, you know, kind of up and down the coast, like, you know, or birds flying north and they, you know, and yes, there's these mechanical type of mechanisms, and you could say, oh, well, there's something that they're picking up on the magnetic pulse or the things or whatever of the earth. But I mean, it's things beyond a conscious awareness.
Yeah.
And so would you describe intuition as things beyond your cognitive process?
Absolutely. And it is a great segue. I want to tell you a study about dogs actually in a moment here.
Okay.
But yeah, and that's a really astute point that, you know, really in a given moment of time, in a present moment, we're really only accessing, you know, it used to be thought about 10% of our, you know, sort of cognitive capacity was conscious. And research more recently is showing that really like 97, 98% of who we are in a moment is completely unconscious out of our awareness. Our ability to be aware of something, to be paying attention to something, is a very thin band of attention that is conscious.
So
seven plus or minus two. And that's if, you know, life is perfect. And really, if you're under stress, it's more like four plus or minus two.
Well, yeah, now we're bombarded even more in our attention span. I mean, I think when that came out with NLP and stuff like that, with that, it was before our attention span went beyond that, or less than that of a goldfish.
Yeah, and so, and what we're talking about here is kind of how many chunks of information, can be, we're pretty much goldfish at this point. How many chunks of information?
We're less than goldfish.
How many chunks of information can you kind of hold in your working memory at in a period of time? And a chunk of information is like, you know, one example would be, you know, I have a blue car, it's a Toyota, it has, you know, this, it's two-wheel drive, it has this, that all kind of comes together as a chunk of information. And when we're stressed out, that's, you know, I noticed, especially when the whole quarantine started in the spring, a lot of folks I was working with became much more forgetful because they were so stressed, and a lot of people were struggling to adjust to, you know, living life from their home. And I just started to notice people, I'm like, I just told you that yesterday. And then I realized, I started reading about stress-induced neuroplasticity and all of that. And so yeah, but the point being, you are so much more than you can possibly be aware of in a moment.
Yeah.
And yeah, and I say that really as encouragement, because we don't, you know, when we're anxious about something or worried about something, we're not remembering in that moment every single thing in our life that we did right, or we, you know, we pushed through that got us to where we are.
Yeah.
You know, that's just gone, right? Our brain is already short circuited. We're not even accessing that. And so, you know, when you're learning something, particularly, you know, whether it's intuition or any skill, be aware that, you know, 99% of who you are is paying complete attention, whether you realize it or not. And, you know, give yourself more credit. And also trust that, you know, you have the answers, and intuition only speaks in the present. I think that's a really important distinction as we're getting into the neuroscience. Intuition doesn't And your intuition is not going to tell you something that you really, that you need to know in 3 weeks. And, mm-hmm. and part of the reason for that is intuition understands how the mind works. Intuition understands how in our society, we think the mind is in control.
Yeah.
Right. We think the mind is in control. Thinking really is just perception.
Yeah.
That's the true definition. It's not looping around thoughts. And so, you know, intuition's not going to give you an insight that you're going to need to solve a major challenge in 3 weeks if your kind of unconscious realizes, well, if I give them this information now, they're just going to be anxious about it. They're going to take it off track. They're going to try and jump ahead. They're going to, you know, kind of meddle with the universe,
yeah.
for lack of a better. So,
but then yet sometimes though, mm-hmm. just challenging that a little
please
bit.
Please do.
Because sometimes your intuition gives you what you need for the future.
Right.
You know, so.
Sometimes it does.
You know,
right.
So they might be it might be preparing you for, you know, like the book that, the example that you gave, mm-hmm. the book that falls on your feet,
right.
that changes the trajectory of your life mm-hmm. moving forward. Or sometimes you just get that nudge that, you know what, I need to grab this and take this with me because, mm-hmm. you know, then you find out that 6 hours later, mm-hmm. the car was broken into or something else happened, but you purposely took that one piece of valuable thing
yes.
you knew. And so it was preparing you for something
right.
in the future.
You don't always know what it's for. And that's,
yes.
that's a good clarification. It might not be that you're not getting intuition in the present about the future, because many of us do. It's just that you're going to get the information that's relevant to the now moment.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Exactly.
Okay. So I can see that. Okay.
Yeah. 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 Well, good clarification.
Because I was like, you know, like sometimes, you know, like that steers you, guides
yeah.
you, has you do some things
yeah.
to protect you for what is soon mm-hmm. to come, you know. And then you hear about all those stories of going into having people not take planes that they just felt that they shouldn't get on a plane for whatever reason, and
yeah.
then later it crashes, or yeah. that, you know, mm-hmm. that they, whatever the case may be,
visit this person and then they pass away,
yeah.
or things like that after you visit them. Yeah. And you know, I think there's something too to highlight, and then I'll tell the dog story of just the why behind even, why should I develop my intuition? Why should I?
Yeah. Well, I would love to hear a little bit more on the science of it
yes.
too, and then
yes.
maybe the why, you know?
Okay.
So
yeah.
Because I think that's fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the science of it. So there's a study that, I think I read this study before I even realized I was preparing to teach people intuition, like 10
okay.
years ago.
See, this is what I mean. Like, I get that yeah. all the time. Like, I'm
right.
constantly micro processing
yeah.
information. I like to learn about subjects that are completely, I don't know anything about. And I like to
yeah.
do that for at least an hour a day,
mm.
Just so I can constantly work my muscles of my mind,
yeah.
learn different things in different
yeah.
fields, whatever the
yeah.
case may be.
Which also downregulates.
But I happen to notice that for whatever reason, whatever I tend to learn, it shows up in a conversation like down the week.
Oh,
and but it was completely random because it's a practice. It was one of my mentors back when I had this tech company. Mm-hmm. He taught that that's what he did, and he created all the success. And so I've taken that on over the years that mm-hmm. that's what I do.
Mm.
But it's time and time again, these random, and when I say random, it can be completely, I go into robotics, or I go into like plants and how, the diversity of plants. Like, I'll do whatever. It's mm-hmm. an hour a day, different subject matter. And it shows up. And
right.
I'd be like, I never even knew anybody knew of anything
yep.
with that. And then there it is. There is a conversation going on about it. And I'm like, and I get to share this knowledge that I just learned, and then people think I'm an expert, but really I just learned or read about it earlier that day.
Yes, yes. I've had that a lot too recently. It's something I read about, I'm talking to someone or working with a client. This happens all the time with clients and workshops. I'll be preparing to teach something. I'll go down some rabbit hole that's completely unrelated, and suddenly I have exactly the metaphor or the information or the resource for the person I hadn't met yet.
Yeah.
You know, it's I have a friend, she's a therapist in New York, and she's like, yeah, it got really weird when I started having dreams about my clients that I haven't met yet. And then I meet them and I'm like, oh yeah. So, the story I was thinking about, or the study I was thinking about is I think we're doing a good job of letting ourselves get excited and then bringing it back.
Yeah.
So bear with us. So the study I want to talk about is Rupert Sheldrake's study that I read about in a Deepak Chopra book. One of Deepak Chopra's books, I think early 2000s, about synchronicity. And Rupert Sheldrake is a researcher in the UK, and he did a study and it was all about, are dogs waiting at the front door when their owners come home because it's the habituation of time and it's tapped into their circadian rhythm, they've memorized it? Or are dogs picking, I mean, you understand the phenomenon that people, you know, dogs are always there. They're always waiting often. Are the dogs picking up on something intuitively, knowing when their owner's coming home? Mm-hmm. So the study was very simple. They got a bunch of people that work 9 to 5, you know, pretty rigid schedules, that kind of person who's going to the same job every day, coming home at the same time. And they had, of course, with their permission, they put cameras in the home, wherever the place, like by the front door, the back door, by the windows, the places the dogs would usually be when the owner comes home, right? So they were looking to see if they, through a triple blind process, had the owner come home earlier, would the dogs be waiting at the door? And if so, at what point when they started their journey home from the office would the dogs get to the door?
Ah, yeah.
Get it? So they're looking at...
Because they're not just sitting at the door the whole time.
Exactly.
So otherwise that would defeat the purpose.
And exactly.
Just, as soon as you laugh, they're there and they never move from the door.
Exactly. You got it. So so dogs are, you know, doing their thing around the house, going out, you know, the doggy door or whatever. And the way they study, you know, it's triple blind. So someone who calls someone who calls someone who calls the guy at the office and, you know, at some random time during the day and says, okay, go home now. Mm-hmm. And what they found was as soon as the owners started pulling out of the parking garage at their office miles away, the dogs migrated to the spot and started to wait, whether it's by the front door, by the window. And they did this study with a number of different people and found consistently that if the owner just decided randomly to come home without fail, just as they started driving home and focusing on getting home, the dogs were, bam, waiting for them in their spot. And
interesting.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting.
So Piggy, you don't wait for me the whole time? You know exactly when I'm going to come home?
She's like, yeah. She just looked up. Yes. So that, you know, I remember reading that. I was like, I don't know, 20 or something. And just thinking, well, that's really interesting.
Yeah.
And what I want to talk about when we get into the neuroscience is how does that, you know, information about, you know, whatever it might be that's coming into your field of awareness, that information of, oh, I should call that person I haven't talked to in 5 years, and then they call. It's kind of a similar pattern in the sense that that person had an intention thinking, oh, maybe I'll call this person, and we pick up on that. That's sort mm-hmm. of the collective unconscious. And really, from a mechanic, from really an electrical, a magnetic, from a neurological standpoint, our heart is sort of our antenna to the collective unconscious, to each other. We're all kind of tapped into the energy of the planet, which is measured. It's actually called the Schumann resonance. I don't mm-hmm. know if you've heard of that, some folks, where
yeah.
you can see
7.82 hertz.
You got it. Exactly. Which is just the energy of the planet. It's kind of where lightning's coming from. It's how the Earth absorbs solar energy. It's where, you know, all of the energy humans are broadcasting impacts it. But our heart space is tapped into it.
The electromagnetic pulse of the Earth. And when people are in tune with it.
Exactly.
We should all be in tune with it. And when they tend to mm-hmm. measure kids that are under 7 years old, they tend to vibrate at 7.82 hertz. Mm-hmm. As we get older, it up or down all over the place. But a few minutes in nature, about 10 minutes in nature, especially if you have your shoes off, it works a little bit better. You can pull yourself back into that alignment and
exactly.
that harmony. But
exactly.
That's why it's so important, but yet so many people don't do it.
Well, and a simple way to engage is just to ground, is to go out into a park and take off your shoes and stand in the grass, and you actually deionize your body. Mm-hmm. As it pertains to intuition, our heart is an electromagnetic field that we're getting into the real deep science here, that extends out from the body really ultimately infinitely. You know, you you can kind of start to understand that if you get into the work of Nikola Tesla, mm-hmm. right? Famous researcher who was uncovering the wireless power. He was able to broadcast power over miles and miles and miles just in the ground safely. Well, not safe for some electrical equipment, but but our heart is picking up on everything that's going on around us. When you walk into a room, perhaps, maybe it's to a party, to an event, and you don't even consciously have time to realize what's going on, but you get a feeling, mm-hmm. Maybe you're like, oh man, I don't like the vibe, or I like the vibe. How is that happening? You're not like, you haven't even looked around to see who's there, to see what's happening. We kind of precognitively feel things through our heart space. And the way that that information becomes conscious, and this is where I think intuition development is really critical. I teach folks mindfulness, self-hypnosis, brainwave entrainment, things like that. Heart breathing out of the Heart Math Research Institute. Yeah, because our nervous system, our spinal column, is the sort of, think of that as like the fiber optic network that is taking the signal in. Like, think about your wireless router, right? You plug it in with a cable to the wall and then it broadcasts it out. It's kind of like your heart is broadcasting out and bringing in information from the collective. And it's precognitive in the sense that you're not aware of it. You might make some decisions that take it into consideration without you realizing it. But the way that you become conscious of it is to entrain your brain, your heart, and your gut so that they're vibrating, that they are communicating at the same frequency.
Yeah.
Because like you were saying, most people, we're, myself included, I get pulled, I take out my phone and 30 minutes later, I'm like, why did I take out my phone? Because I'm like, I got lost in Twitter. We're so stimulated and pulled out of ourselves that actually most of us, if we're not being intentional, our heart space, it's almost like on a different radio station than our brain.
And your gut.
Our gut. Yeah.
I wonder why everybody has autoimmune diseases now and other types of stress and anxiety and depression. It's like, we're so freaking out of alignment.
Yeah. Well, did you know we have three brains?
Yeah.
We have three brains, right? So our gut is a brain, our heart is a brain, and our head is a brain, because they're huge, large amounts of neurons. And like you were saying, people have a lot of autoimmune disease, people have a lot of mental health issues that, a lot of it comes down to the fact that the gut synthesizes serotonin, and the cognitive processing that's happening in your gut isn't communicating well with your brain.
Well, there's so much new research coming mm-hmm. out on that, but I think just to clarify what Michael's saying is that these three hearts is to actually have different components and different ratios of neurocells. So mm-hmm. Like your gut is 40% neurocells. Mm-hmm. So that's, I forget exactly what the heart is, it's a little less,
it's about 50,000.
Yeah, but I mean, a comparison of like the cell ratio.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, so, mm-hmm. so I know 40% for your gut, but so it's literally, it has brain mm-hmm. cells in there, the same cells that are in your brain. But interesting, we're deviating a little bit. I hope you guys appreciate this, because everything's connected, right? And so the more that you can connect the gut and the mind and the depression and the different things, is that there's a lot of your microbiome mm-hmm. and there's a lot going on now that they're doing mm-hmm. research. They were doing a lot of research with children with autism and doing mm-hmm. like fecal transplants and mm-hmm. having them massively have a lot of their symptoms and reactions and outbursts that they would have, and their inability to control some of their anger and their mm-hmm. frustration and stuff massively get corrected with a simple mm-hmm. Reorganization of the microbiome. And they're now doing that with depression and anxiety. Mm-hmm. And so like everything is so interlinked. Yeah. But while you were describing what I was seeing, as you're describing like your mind, your gut, your heart, and like all of these networks, and this ability to, how important you were talking about your spinal column and everything, having that
be, you sit up straight.
having that be in alignment. And so that this is like, if we are this radius of more than our brain mm-hmm. to understand this world, like how is intuition, doesn't even have to be anything hooey wooey. It can be just using different apparatuses within your system, like how dolphins have a sonar system, you know, right. It's like it's tapping into this, mm-hmm. but you can't feel the difference if you're right. so out of alignment, you're not even noticing the subtleties right. hitting your field. Right. I mean, some people can feel, like you were given that great example, walking into a room and just feeling the toxic energy. Yeah. But some people are so disconnected from their feelings and awareness that they don't even feel that. You can be in a group of five people, you yeah. all walk into the same room, and some people feel like it makes their skin crawl. Others are feeling like, I just don't feel comfortable. I don't know what it is. One person might be able to, yeah. this is just not good. And another person completely oblivious.
Right.
They're not even feeling it. It doesn't mean that they can't feel it, but they're so,
exactly.
you know what I'm saying?
Exactly. Well, and I'll say, so it's kind of like you were explaining, I appreciate that. We have these three brains. We have a gut brain and a heart brain and a head brain. And so to really take control or to really take full advantage of what your intuition is doing, remember, because, you know, 99% of us, we're just unaware of who we, of what's happening in our brain and body in terms of what we're conscious of. It's really important to be in alignment, but to also then intentionally target your intuition. And I say that, and I'll give an example kind of similar to walking into a room. You know, think about how if you're in a good mood and you say you go to a party, you tend to have a good time at the party, right? It could be maybe the music's too loud, but you just talk louder. Maybe you don't know anyone, but you're feeling good. You're like, well, yeah, I'll meet some new people. I don't like the drinks they have. Well, it's fine. I won't worry about having a drink. And you just kind of have an experience, and maybe you meet some new people there. Maybe you get some new ideas that really help you out. But you could go to that same party in a crummy mood.
Yeah.
And what happens? The music's too loud. Well, I'm just not going to talk to anyone. I don't want to get a sore throat. I don't like anything to drink here. Well, I'm just going to leave then. I don't know anyone here. Oh, I don't want to meet any new people.
Yeah.
Right? And what'll happen is, you know, different information hangs out at different states of awareness, different states of your nervous system and things like that. So intuition is the same way. So if you're thinking all these negative thoughts, your intuition is just going to make your life more negative. It's going to give you all the information and get you to do things that are just going to make you more the way that you're feeling.
Yeah. And perpetuate that. I love that. It's like an example, which would, for those that are, you know, into vibration, right? Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
So this is a different way to look at when people say, oh, you know, you're vibrating at that level, so you're attracting that.
Mm-hmm.
I think what you're saying, Michael, is that it's also, it's even on like on a more like wavelength type of also your perception, is that you're in that space, that's what you notice,
mm-hmm.
you know, like
yeah.
you notice the things in conversation. If you're in a down mood, you notice the negativity mm-hmm. in the room. You notice yeah. the irritations, the different things. You're positive, you notice the positive, right?
Exactly.
And so you can say, what are you vibrating at when we get into mm-hmm. way hooey wooey, or we can even just say on a psychological level,
yeah.
where are you at? Because that's mm-hmm. what you're noticing.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And it's, you know, from the vibration metaphor, which I think is a great one, it's like, you know, if you remember using car radios, or, you know, radios, I'm sure everyone remembers, you know, you turn.
Radio. Not everybody
so
remembers. There's some millennials that watch this.
You know, remember the old floppy disks?
Oh my God.
I used to work in schools, and I loved it because we found some one day in a closet, and all the little kids were like, oh, it's the save icon. Isn't that cute? And we're like, yeah, it's the save icon. They thought it was a toy.
Oh my God. It's like, you're like, yeah, you know, once upon a time, there was things that you had to dial the numbers like
no.
this on a phone.
That must have taken forever. How did you remember them? It's seven numbers.
And you had to pull your finger all the way around. And if you put your finger in the wrong one.
A rotary phone. But you know, it's like, you're going to hear. If you tune your radio to a station, you're going to hear the music or whatever shows on that station, whether you want to or not, until you change the dial.
Yeah.
And so we can use our nervous system to bring our three brains into alignment, because when we're vibing at different frequencies in our gut, in our heart, and our brain, instead of our nervous system being able to do more for us, our nervous system is having to translate all these signals and, you know, try to put everything together. And literally, I mean, it actually, this is why like mindfulness can actually physiologically you know, heal ailments sometimes, you know, many of them, because our nervous system, our, you know, our communication between our brainstem and our body is so clogged up with, you know, just being sort of internally a little bit disorganized. That's kind of the norm for a lot of folks. So when we tune everything to the same vibration. And, you know, when I teach it, through just simple mindfulness, through self-hypnosis techniques, through brainwave entrainment. Folks, it's a lot of what's happening when you're meditating anyway.
Gotcha.
You're bringing yourself in alignment. So it's like you've closed all the tabs on your computer and now it's working faster. Information's getting through. It's not clogged up.
So would this be one of the reasons why, like, you know, what's the motivation? Mm-hmm. I get like, yeah, non-clogged up, but what's the motivation for people to actually want to develop their mm-hmm. intuition and mm-hmm. to have that awareness?
Yeah, well, and it's a good question.
Because, you know, they say ignorance is bliss.
Ignorance is bliss.
I'm thinking back to me talking about the five people walking in the room and the one person, the other one's saying, I'm like the person that my skin's crawling to get me out of here.
Well, I mean, some people use their intuition to rake in big bucks with the stock market. You know, that's not how I've been desire to use it, but some people use their intuition to solve problems. That's one of my favorites. And I'm just thinking back and thinking about all of the times that, you know, something in my life, some situation, something I had to work on or whatever got really complicated. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the old me, or I think what a lot of us do is we try to figure out the solution. You know, we're making calls, we're taking steps. And it's really starting to learn how to take a step back and say I have, you know, it happens all the time with scheduling in my life. Like my schedule gets all screwed up and I'm like, I'm like, wait a second. I step back from it. And, you know, maybe I was thinking about calling a person to reschedule or canceling something or whatever. And I step back and I think about those things and I feel nothing in my gut. I feel nothing in my chest, because one of the ways intuition speaks through our brains and our body is, you know, the gut sense, the heart sense, right? When you feel something in your gut, when you feel something in your heart, like, that's a pretty good sign that you're moving something forward in a positive way, even if you don't understand how it's going to work out.
Yeah.
So what I found is when I do that, when I step back, when I take a moment, make sure I'm in what, you know, what a lot of folks call coherence, right? On the same frequency, really lined up internally. I'll often realize, well, I think this person is going to get in touch with me, and because they're going to need to change it. Like my intuition will just kind of say something specific like that, or it might just say, no, hold off for a minute. And then, like, you know, an hour later, if it's the scheduling issue, I get an email like, hey, can we meet an hour later? And I'll be like, yep, that's actually when we need to meet, and, you know, things like that. So intuition is a way to address challenges in your life, whether it's in work, in relationships. I had a student in one of my seminars over the summer who, a great guy, had made some big life changes. He was in New York City doing work on Broadway. So like basically the pandemic hit and his whole life was just put on pause. And he and his partner really loved each other, but started having all these relationship issues. They're arguing, trying to figure things out. And it was just funny. They applied these techniques and they were like, oh, we're just best friends. And he wrote me after the seminar and he's like, yeah, this whole conflict that I was so afraid of, like even knowing, you know, at some level that the relationship needed to end, somehow, like, he was like, I just knew that there was a moment where I just had to say this thing about the relationship. And I said it, and literally it was like, between both of them. And I was like, great. And it was so interesting because most people who are going to tell me that they just left a relationship after, you know, when I'm in seminars or even just a friend, you think you want to hug them. They're going to be crying. They're going to be sad. But he was like, I never imagined that this transition could be so smooth and meaningful.
And that's what I'm hearing over and over in some of the metaphors and the stories that you are providing, is the smoothness in this kind of floating through life mm-hmm. instead of fighting against life type of energy. Yeah. You know, whether it's with the client that needs to reschedule, or this mm-hmm. example of somebody following their intuition and what's really there and speaking their truth in the relationship. And it's like, I think when we go against what is in our alignment, because if we go back through all of this, we're it's almost like you're saying synonymous with alignment is mm-hmm. intuition. It's like all mm-hmm. three of these minds come into alignment. Mm-hmm. And when you're in alignment, you're in flow. And if you think about a river and you're floating down the river, you're in flow. If you're suddenly like, what most of us do is we try to resist the current. Mm-hmm. We're trying to like or self back
up. I've been
up.
Stuck in a riptide before.
Yeah. And it's like, you know, because we think that we need to be going a different direction because that's what our mind is so willful there. Our emotions are so overpowering that they're so attached to something that isn't right for us or doesn't feel, you know,
right.
or vice versa. I mean, go through it. I mean, each of these different minds will get sometimes when they're in conflict with each other, mm-hmm. we've all been there, you know, like, massively love somebody, but you know that they're horrible for you, yeah. or feel that something is the right thing to do, mm-hmm. but you know, like, it doesn't, your heart doesn't right. want it, or your stomach just gives you this like thing, but your mind says, no, this is yeah. the right direction to go. and but when you're in alignment, it seems like it's like floating down a lazy river.
Exactly.
And it's like, nowhere for me to go or do. This is all exactly. the right course. I don't need to fight anything. And that's what I'm hearing is mm-hmm. maybe the one biggest benefit of working for in developing your intuition is allowing you to be in this alignment yeah. that when life happens and you have to make decisions and do different turns and mm-hmm. and go different directions in your life, you're not fought with
exactly.
friction.
Right. It's really learning how to lead more with your subconscious mind than with your conscious mind is really what intuition can be. And I like how you kind of were, you were gesturing kind of like when we get into a part of the current that's rough, when we get stuck in a riptide in our lives, when really to succeed and get through it, we just need to surrender, right? Yeah. Like I was swimming down in Florida with my brother a few years back, and you know, we're swimming in the ocean and all of a sudden we're like, I can't touch the ground and I can't get to the beach. And we're like we got to the point where we're like, should we call for help? And then we both just kind of gave up on trying to swim back and we floated back, right? That's kind mm-hmm. of how those currents were. Yeah, it was a little scary. But, you know, we often, when we're stuck in a scenario in our life that is troubling to us, that we're worrying about, that we're stressed about, that is causing us anxiety, we are conditioned to think about it, right? Mm-hmm. And that's our conscious mind just spinning and spinning and spinning all on its own. And our gut brain, our heart brain, that's our subconscious mind, right? That's most of who we are. That's where all of our, you know, all our wisdom and knowledge is. It's where all of our skills are stored. Everything, you know, we're capable of is always there and available to us as tools. But when we're just spinning, we just push all this nonsense down through the pipe, and we never give our subconscious sort of inner wisdom, and which is really our strength, come up, which is really our intuition, come up through our nervous system. So it's really, I think it's something like everyone does many things in their lives with their intuition. Like if you just are thinking about this for a second, looking back at your life, you know, maybe you've had some stressful times, but you've gotten through them in ways you couldn't have expected. How did you do that? You know, you are strong, you are powerful, you have these innate tools, and it's kind of like a little bit of a self-reprogramming. You know, it's kind of like just kind of starting to build the neural pathways to, you know, catch yourself in the spinning. I call it living intuitively, which is kind of like what I've been trying to do, which is like, you know, as much as I can, I wake up in the morning and let the day unfold.
Yeah.
Right. Not always possible. So you have to make appointments, you have obligations, but it's how can I allow myself to wake slowly and really see what bubbles up and really set an intention. And then just get into the current. And I mean, I say like, I do that every day. My life is perfect. Hell no. I get stressed out all the time. You know, I get sidetracked all the time.
Well, you know, you wouldn't want it if it was not. You know, like so many people, my clients too, they're like, I just want things to be easy and perfect. It's like, no, you don't. Well, you don't. If we gave everybody a dose of Pleasantville, and people probably don't even know that movie reference, but if... you'd be so bored that,
yeah.
You know, you look for that. And what are we here? We're here growing and evolving, you know? Mm-hmm. They say, whoever they is, but there's a saying out there that says, if you're not growing, you're dying. So mm-hmm. if you're not evolving, you're decaying. And so, yeah. You know, I don't know. That's... There's so much to learn and do. And when you stop, like, it's going back to that perception mm-hmm. situation of the worst or the best, or like, yeah. it's all happening, you know, when you realize that life is happening for you and not to you, and that experiences can mm-hmm. all be teaching and lessons mm-hmm. and opportunities, you invite the challenges in your life.
That's
you invite
right.
it, and you say, wow, this gives me a chance to learn, level yep. up a little bit. Not saying that it's not going to be stressful at times, or that there's not some high stakes that are at play, whether in love and family and mm-hmm. finances and career. It's all really real stuff, I mean, because it affects you, but when you really pull yourself out of it, it's not yeah. really that real of stuff, you know?
Right. Well, it's like hiking up a mountain, right? You're not going to get to that vista point unless you sweat a little. And then once you get there, that's when you say, well, let's hang here for a while. Let's take out the sandwiches we brought. Let's enjoy life. Let's enjoy this place we've taken ourselves to. And most people then, they're like, oh, let's go up to the next one. Let's keep going. Or let's come back tomorrow. That's kind of... It's moving ourselves into a sort of higher state of perception, a higher state of consciousness. And I think an important thing to mention too about intuition development is effort counts. And this is really, again, getting into that building the neural pathways so that instead of clogging up your system and being all different vibrations, you're more in coherence and letting the flow of information come up into your conscious awareness, into your mind, from your subconscious, through your heart, from the collective unconscious, and also with what you're putting out, is to really understand neuroplasticity. Mm-hmm. Which is the brain and really the entire nervous system and body's capacity to change. Our brains are alive. They're never the same. They're really just, our brain is really an automation machine, right? It just learns what we do repetitively and then just starts making it things we can do without thinking about it. Which is why like habits of anxiety are habits. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't realize we created them. So the way self-directed neuroplasticity works is simply this. It's simply choosing where you direct your thought. Mm-hmm. And again, it's like, it's not like, you know, right overnight, you're just going to be able to stay completely focused on the positive and everything's good. Effort counts. Every time you just take a second longer to pause, notice what's happening in your body, notice where, wow, I can't even really fully feel my body like I'm so in my head. And you just take a moment to say, get into your body. It's like drawing lines in the sand. It's each time you drag your finger across the sand, the neural pathway gets stronger. Yeah. It gets deeper. And so you'll start to surprise yourself. And I imagine many of you who maybe do yoga or who meditate or any other sort of healing modality, you know, it starts out as, I don't think it's working, right? It starts out as, I taught a course on mindfulness the other night to folks at a library. So, you know, they're all beginners, they're coming to learn about it. And they said, oh, I tried to meditate once, but I kept getting distracted. And I was like, that's good, right? Because yeah. that's the whole thing. You get distracted and then you come back. That's building the neural pathway. So if you were to say, really be intentional about wanting to live more intuitively, to step back and let your subconscious speak first before you make a decision, letting all, you know, more wisdom come in, thinking through something instead of thinking, you know, of something or of a solution, you start to build these neural pathways that, you know, maybe, you know, next week, if you kind of take a moment each day to just be quiet with it and to meditate on it, you might notice in a week that there are a couple times where spontaneously you just took a pause and you let a different piece of information come through that changed an outcome. And then a month later, you might realize, well, it's almost like happening like four times a week now.
Yeah.
And, you know, a year later, you might be like, wow, I'm just doing it automatically like five times a day. And we slip up, we have these old habits, these neural networks are programmed, but the beauty is the more in your life you just take a moment to pause and say, you know, maybe it's a deep breath. And I think we're going to record a little meditation video that I use for intuition development. So that'll hopefully be linked here.
So if you, we're going to have that link down below, but if you found it first, you can go back and listen to it again.
Exactly. So I'll teach some techniques that you'll have access to, but you can use, you know, whatever helps you find calm and peace. You just start noticing yourself automatically doing that, like while you're walking down the street, while you're taking a bite out of a sandwich, while you're working, and you just start to notice, well, where am I? Like, where am I? What's happening? You know, just take 30 seconds, and it's like the information that you didn't even know you needed starts to come in. The thing about that just makes you feel good about later, like maybe you have something happening later in the day and you just get this insight that makes you feel now you're really excited about that. You're like, ooh, I can do that. You know?
Yeah.
And you just get used to it throughout your day. And that's actually really important because neurons that fire together wire together. So those
that's
a neuroscience
neurons that fire together
it's like Schoolhouse Rocks. So you have all these neural networks of all these habits of anxiety, of whatever the habits are that you have, you know, as you start to
like families that eat together stay together.
Exactly. Friends that hike together stay together. You want to actually not just like meditate all on your own in your comfy place at home. You actually want to like have these little bits of meditation, mindfulness, self-hypnosis, where you're maybe with the intention of targeting and tapping into your intuition, because you want those neural networks that get triggered throughout your day to become associated with these new ones you're building, so that they eventually go like this and move towards positivity, because the brain does, if you give it the opportunity, it will move towards positivity, meaning old habits, all the power that was behind them starts to become the power behind the good ones you're trying to develop. So say your goal is, you know, to be calmer, to be more peaceful, to be more in touch with your intuition. And, you know, when you notice yourself getting stressed during the workday, you just take 30 seconds. Maybe you're even still doing what you're doing and you're just like consciously breathing. You are creating associations with the stress, with the good feelings, and the good feelings will win in the end.
Yeah. And this is important to, you know, just reiterate that the ability to change, right? Yeah. And how with, I think a lot of times people know that with effort and energy on something, like let's like if we looked at something completely different, like let's say if somebody was training to do a marathon but they never ran really, right? The first day they might only run a couple blocks. They might be like, I'm never going to be able to run 26.2 miles, right? But if they keep on showing up and do that a little bit more, before they know it, they're running 10 miles in the morning, they're running 15, and then they're ready, and then marathon day comes, and they knock the 26.2 out of the park. Like,
it's the muscle.
It's that training, habit forming response, because soon you get anchored into those associations and those neural pathways. And so, you know, I don't think there's anybody that's watching that wouldn't doubt that somebody giving a little bit of effort and energy, because we've seen it so many times in the physical that our mind can associate and say, yes, that is possible. Because, you know, like whether that's with any type of fitness regimen, right? And we say, okay, yes, people put in that effort, they can do that. We see shows like, you know, the biggest loser, the different things, like with effort and energy, people can lose weight with effort and energy, people can become fit with effort and energy. you can develop your intuition and mindfulness.
Absolutely.
You know, but it's harder because it's an internal process versus a physical thing that somebody can measure.
Well, and I also think the external benchmarks in the world for how even legitimate intuition is, or being psychic is, or being a medium is, sometimes don't actually speak the truth. And, you know, I was thinking, you're talking about training to run. I was thinking about the 4-minute mile.
Yeah.
And how up until, I guess, was about the early 70s, it was thought that no one could run a mile in 4 minutes. And I forget the gentleman who...
Roger Berenstein.
Roger Berenstein. After Roger Berenstein ran it, how many people after that were able to run a 4-minute mile?
6 or 7 people in the following year.
Never
it's been
thought
thousands.
Possible.
Yeah.
And so what, you know, it's also just kind of... just having that idea in your mind that there's a lot more possibility around how intuition, about how channeling, how psychic abilities, whatever they might be, whatever, you know, naturally is your talent when it comes to intuition, that actually that can become the backbone of your success in life. And you don't even have to tell anyone.
Yeah.
Like I said, you know, I realized in hindsight, looking back an entire decade of my life, I'm like, oh my gosh, like I always knew I always was like kind of self-aware of the fact that like the way I was making certain decisions in my life was, you know, like not how other people did, you know, moving to a new city before getting a job. And yeah, I've done that a lot. And, but being completely successful in it, being exactly the job I needed for where I was in my development, and being kind of, you know, you almost feel a little ostracized sometimes because that's so against the mainstream.
Yeah, it's against the logic a lot of times because oftentimes these two are so much more powerful, and it's sometimes it will make logical sense and they'll all like be like, of course, da-da-da-da-da. But a lot of times you just have this knowing and it's not necessarily... okay, yeah, it makes more sense to go left, but for whatever reasons, I feel like I should turn right.
Yeah.
But there's nothing that would tell you going through your cognitive process that right is appropriate. In fact, you might have a stacking the deck of all of the reasons why left is appropriate. Yeah. But for whatever reason, that feels the right way to go.
Absolutely.
And then you turn down there and you're like, wow, what is this place?
Right. And exactly.
Or there's a job, or there's my new lover. There's the, you know?
Yeah. I mean, sometimes just walking around a neighborhood will create a whole new career. You know, wow, I never thought of a business like that before, right?
Yeah.
And what if you didn't walk down that street? Yeah, it's intuition is magical, but it's also grounded in reality. It's also grounded in our nervous systems, in spiritual traditions and practices, and you know, it's even all throughout parts of the different federal agencies use intuition productively, believe it or not. It's a, you know, I've thought of it and I've heard of it as, you know, think about intuition more like a phenomena. It's not a fantastical, you know, like X-Men skill where it's like you can fly or generate magnetism, as much as it is a natural phenomena that is always active, but it's a question of how awake are you to its power? How awake and willing are you to turn right when everyone is telling you to turn left?
Yeah.
You know, and to just know that you always have the freedom to go down that street again, you know, but going down a path in your life where your heart isn't in it, or your gut isn't in it, you know, over time, that's just, it just wears on the human body. It wears on the human soul. It wears on our spirit. It hurts to see when I see someone in my life who I care about, like going against their intuition and knowing it and respecting their sovereignty. And it's the same for myself when I realize, wow, I thought my way through all kinds of stuff that I think I just need to drop because my heart wasn't in it.
Yeah.
And so learning how to, learning how to be present with your heart is, I think, the best way to target and be authentic with your intuition, whether you're consciously thinking about what you want it to do for you or not. Staying in the heart really, it really puts you in a place where you can just jump at a moment's notice without skipping a beat, because it's who you are, right? Our hearts are sort of our identity in a lot of ways, where that lives.
Well, and it sounds like also it's about building self-trust.
Absolutely.
And I think
Start small. Don't go move to a new city. Go try to find a really good cup of coffee with your intuition first.
Yeah, but that alignment and that relationship with yourself and that trust with yourself, yeah. I think is the biggest thing that I see missing in people.
Yeah.
And, yeah. you know, when you know that no matter what, you're going to be okay. Yeah. And just like you said, you can always go back down that path. When you know that there are no mistakes, when you know that it's all okay.
It's all just new information.
Coming at you in whatever vibration. Good vibration. So
good,
I think that that's
good
vibration.
I love the Beach Boys.
So
here in LA.
I feel like that might be like a good place to kind of start drawing to an end here. I want
Absolutely.
People to know where they can find you. So I'm guessing that some of your intuition courses you're doing now over Zoom and things like that with the pandemic.
Yeah.
So where can people find you? Dive in, see if there's, you know, we're going to have that meditation that we're going to link down below so you can get a little sample of what that being in alignment's like for a few minute practice that you can go over. But then if you want to start to dive even further and learn more, discover more, where can they find you?
So, well, first of all, I'll be teaching some workshops in December and into the new year through Liberate. So you'll be able to find me on the website.
Yes.
And really, you know, workshops about intuition development and learning how to channel and trust your inner wisdom. You know, and I didn't say this in the podcast, but believe it or not, or in the conversation, I just want to say it real quick, believe it or not, your body and your nervous system is actually really about 80% internally facing.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, which we do not spend 80% of our day, right? We're all, so.
Oh, I think we spend.
I think it's the opposite, right? And so. This development of self-trust will come over time with just learning and proving to yourself through small action that, wow, I can go inside and get an answer that's going to change something outside of me.
Yeah.
And then you're like I said, you know, I'm just going to not go on Yelp and see if I can find that good lunch, you know, and then do that. And then it's like, I'm not going to plan my weekend. I'm just going to see what happens, you know, and then it's maybe like, well, you know what, I'm going to go on a trip, but I'm not going to learn anything about where I'm going and just let it flow. And then maybe it's move to another city and get a day, you know, but yeah, folks, you can find me on the Liberate site for my workshops. I post pretty much about all the things I'm doing. And I post a lot of educational videos about intuition on Instagram. And so my Instagram, which I imagine we can link, is at michael.intuit, I-N-T-U-I-T. I was like,
we'll put it there. Don't worry.
Yeah. Michael.intuit. And my website is michaelcarson.net. So I have some YouTube videos and things as well. A lot of stuff you can check out and link to from there.
Sounds good. Well, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Christina. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody. Please like, share this video. And if you're listening to this on iTunes or Spotify or any of those platforms, it's really good if you can rate us, leave a comment. It helps more people find us. If you're watching this on YouTube, please do the same down below. And thank you.
Until
next time.
Hi, this is Cristina Dam, and this is Liberate the Podcast, where we educate, motivate, inspire, and liberate your consciousness.